You know, the Lord does not mince words with me. He is not going to allow me to dilute the word, water it down for you, or make it fuzzy so that you will like it better. He has said, tell your people the truth, be honest with them, and lay it out. Anything you see coming, you warn them about it in advance, just like you would your kids. If you know that it's dangerous to walk in traffic, you tell your kids, it's dangerous to walk in traffic, don't do that. So, this is kind of a cool message, because God preached it to me 4 different ways, at least. So I'm going to tell you a story. I've been waiting to tell this story for a while. It goes a little bit with what we have shared. 12 tribes of Israel refused to go into the promised land. Actually, it was only 10. 2 came back with a good report and said, we can go and take the land right now, let's conquer it. 10 came back with a very negative report, and they told lies, it says. 40 days they spied out the land, and when they returned, Caleb told the people to be quiet and listen to Moses. Really, what he said is, shut up. Let's go now and take possession of the land. We should be more than able to conquer it. More than able to conquer it. But the men who had gone with him said, we can't attack these people. They're too strong for us. So they began to spread lies among the Israelites about the land they had explored. And they said, the people are really tall. They're giants. It is scary, really scary in that land. We can't take it. We will get devoured and eaten alive. Didn't matter what God said. These 10 men were very respected. It was more important what they said, apparently. So God let them wander the wilderness for 40 years, and when they eventually died off, their heirs got the land. I like that. Now you have a whole new generation. He says, okay, your kids are inheriting the land. They get it. Very cool. I like that. Problem being, 3 of the tribes said, I don't know that we want to go over there and get the land, because, you know, the grass is greener over here in East Jordan. I'm not lying. It's exactly what it says. To the east of the Jordan, the grass is greener. We really like this land better than the promised land. And I'll tell you what, Caleb, Joshua said, you're going to go through this again, really? You already angered God the very first time you refused to go in to what he gave you so that he could keep you and he could protect you in that land. But no, you want to be scattered all over the place? They said, oh, we'll go in and help you conquer it. When we're done, do you think after we conquered it, we could come back? Because the grass is greener on the east side of the Jordan. I thought that was a God pun, personally. East Jordan, you know. I laughed at it. Whole message in that, guys. I went, really? So they went in and conquered the land, and when they got done, they went back and they moved east of the Jordan. Eventually, they immigrated into France and Belgium and Switzerland, and I believe Nigeria. They are now running home. Finally, after all these years, they have figured out when God said, take the land and live in this land, he knew what he was saying. They're under great persecution in France and Belgium and Switzerland, and they're leaving in droves. We will discuss that on Wednesday night. I love the story. I thought it was really good. I said, Lord, where do you want me to go with that? And I love how God begins to talk to me. He says things, he'll tell me where to look for research even. The greatest blockage you're going to have to following God and what he says for you is your carnal mind. It's between your ears. It runs from here to here.
Amen.
The natural mind was designed to function in a natural world, natural logic, and understanding things. You've been given the keys to the kingdom when you were born again. Everything of God dwells within you. His spirit, all of his gifts. Everything lies within you, but you don't know it. You've never tapped into it. And if you obey your carnal mind, you'll never find the mind of Christ, which dwells within you. The scripture of the morning, I think I call it my scripture of the morning, is found in, let me say 1 Corinthians. You have the 2 Corinthians, you have the mind of Christ. If you can pull that up. You have the mind of Christ, and the wisdom of God is formed within you. Find me that, Matthew, if you can. You have the mind of Christ. Look at the person next to you. Say, I have the mind of Christ.
I have the mind of Christ.
What is it? 9:8. 2 Corinthians 9:8. I want you to turn to it. Michael's going to pop it up here. And God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that you, having all sufficiency in all good works, may abound to every good work. That's not it. I want the one that says you have the mind of Christ. I know it. Here it is. 2:16. 2 Corinthians 2:16. I know it was in there. I just picked the wrong one. That was a good scripture too, though. I like that. 2:16. Yeah. 1 Corinthians 2:16. Well, let's just do this. Let's just take a tour today. That's what I kind of feel like we're doing. 1 Corinthians 2:16. Can you read it out loud?
For who has known or understood the mind of the Lord so as to guide and instruct him and give him knowledge? But we have the mind of Christ and do hold the thoughts of his heart.
For who hath known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. So we're going to talk a little bit about today, a blockage between your ears. It's your natural logic. It's your natural understanding. It is your five senses. It cannot sense spiritual things. You have to deal with it every day. Your carnal mind does the dishes, bakes bread, cleans the floor, and vacuums, fixes the car. Your spiritual mind deals with fear and how you address it, anxiety and how you address it. It will deal with how you address gossip and all the emotional issues you go through. It will also deal with healing, prosperity, and everything you know is true in the Word of God. Apparently, those 10 spies did not know this information, and no one had taught them. So they operated in the carnal. We saw giants in the land, and they're really big, and they're going to eat us up for supper. So I want to tell you something, and I want you to understand it real clear. It's important that we get out of our carnal mind and into the mind of God. Romans 10:10 says, for with the heart man believes unto righteousness. With the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. It did not say with the mind. With the mind, man believes unto righteousness. It said with the heart. This is your spirit, man. It rides in here. That's why when you know you need to pray, mamas call it a sixth sense. They get this feeling like something's wrong with one of their kids. Or they need to pray. And it's within here. It's not here. That is your spirit man. Romans 8:7 says, the carnal mind is in enmity with God. It is hostile to God. It is not subject to the laws of God. It cannot be. You cannot train your carnal mind to be like God. It is impossible. It's been sitting on the throne most your lives of your mind. You cannot train it. Look at the person next to you and say, you cannot train your carnal mind. To think like God.
To think like God.
It's an impossibility. But when you were born again, you were given the mind of Christ.
Amen.
It's always in conflict. Always in conflict and always hostile to and in enmity with God. It's always coming against the mind of Christ. So I went to go pray for a woman. Her name is Deborah. And she had bronchitis really bad. 2 weeks ago. Got to her house. I could see her breathing was a little low. Her oxygen levels were a little low. Had Nick go get the medical kit. Of course, he did a little O2 sensor, a little blood pressure. We listened to her breathing. We did the whole little medical thing and, you know, gave her a little assessment. And I told her what she could do in the natural. And the Lord goes, are you here to pray for her? Because totally, my carnal mind was doing this thing. My mind of Christ was entirely confused. You're going to pray for her, but in the middle of your prayer, you're thinking about her O2 levels and how you could bring them up. Talk about double-minded. You know, James says this, a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Your pastor was very unstable that day. I left and I said, Nick, I can't do this. Literally, I can't pray correctly. I was fighting the spirit man the entire time. The mind of Christ was fighting in me to get me to pray with faith, a prayer of faith. I couldn't even pray a prayer of faith. My carnal mind was going, you need to look at that system. Have you checked her pulse? Well, you know, she looks a little flushed over here. What if she did this? Has she taken her inhaler? I'm serious, guys. I had the worst battle. I called Deborah on the phone. I said, Deborah, something is totally fighting against me when I come to pray for you. My spirit wants to pray for you. Instead, I immediately go into EMS. Okay, Nick, I don't know that it was ever a blessing that I ever took EMS. Maybe it was a curse.
Oh, no.
That I know how the body works and how it's supposed to run because it is fighting me the entire time I pray. And then I stumble upon these words. I love it. Some of our prayer team have already taken this training. You have the mind of Christ. You've been given the mind of Christ. It just says it right here. Who hath known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. 1 Corinthians 2:16. It says that the carnal mind is at enmity with God. It's hostile. Okay. Then why on earth am I wrestling against it? All right, that was your appetizer. Now you're in for the sermon. This is the good one. I'm going to bring it on to you. Because this is what you surely will know. The Lord said to me, tell your people in the next 6 months, if they don't know this information, they're going to be discouraged, depressed, filled with anxiety and worry. They have got to know this information. You have got to know that the carnal mind never, never tells the truth in some, I mean, the devil never tells the truth to your carnal mind, is what I wanted to say. He lies to it. He will give you imaginations that your kid is dead alongside the road when really they're just late coming home. Instantly you get an image. Oh my gosh. Your carnal mind will just run with that. You'll see the price change in the grocery store and your carnal mind will say, oh gosh, you're never going to be able to afford me the rest of your life. The price is too high. Wow. Your carnal mind will see what's going on in the media. And there's a lot that's happened this week with China, North Korea, us sending nuclear warplanes to fight ISIS. Yeah, everybody knew that one, wasn't it true? All the military lining up in Saudi Arabia, 1/3 of 1 million troops, 20,000 tanks in the Middle East. So what does that mean? You'll find that out on Wednesday night. What you need to know now is you begin to see the media and the news kick in. Instantly, the carnal mind will go into, oh my gosh, what is going on? This concerns me. If you let your carnal mind talk to you, you will certainly become depressed, filled with anxiety and worry. If you let the mind of Christ, I said that wrong, I think. The carnal mind. If you let the mind of Christ begin to speak to you, it'll say, no. You come under my dwelling, under my wings, under my protection. No plague comes nigh your dwelling. Nothing will hurt you. Follow after me and obey my commandments. I'll be your provision. Who cares about the price of meat? I'll provide what you need have if you ask me. Right. You begin to follow this voice. But the minute you allow this carnal mind, I had to go in, pick my carnal mind up this last week. I picked my carnal mind up, I sat it on the shelf, and I told it, park it. Stay there, I'll pick you up when I need to make banana bread. But you're not coming out. While I'm studying the Word, you cannot feed your carnal mind enough scriptures to train it. Remember how they said, renew your mind daily? It meant renew your spirit mind daily. You can teach all the scriptures in the world to help bring it in line, and it will still tell you, oh no, I don't think you can do that. You know, I just don't think how. It's the logic of you. It carries the logic part of you. It carries the doctor's report that tells you, when the doctor says, honey, you're going to die, and I need to let you know this. You've got only 6 months to live. That's the carnal mind. I have seen people immediately go, oh, doc, what you don't know is this is what God's word says.
Amen.
So Nick and I went to the hospital to pray for a gentleman who had died. He was on life support. Heart was working. He wasn't on a, you know,
respirator.
He was on a respirator, ventilator, but he wasn't, you know, on anything that made his heart beat. I don't even know what that's called now anymore. EMS just left my mind. I put it on the shelf and it parked. I couldn't even remember. Put it this way. He was hooked up to so many hoses. I've never seen this many hoses. So we went in and prayed. And we prayed for his body, commanded it to work, to function, and to heal. Do you know what happened? His body began to function and heal. So Doc comes in 2 days later. We had gone 3 times during those 2 days. Doc comes in and he's standing there. He says, well, his body looks really good. Every part of it's great. I said, we've been praying, Doc, over his body. He goes, well, somebody has been. His body is really good. And I said, how would you pray? He said, I began to pray for the mind. What I didn't know is he told the family he had less than 0% chance of coming out of this without severe brain damage. I didn't know that till yesterday. Less than 0%. They said, we will give him absolutely zero hope. They released him after 9 days. They call him the miracle, as he would walk down the hall, because he had absolutely no neurological damage. He didn't have short-term memory loss, which we had prayed over. He didn't have anything wrong with him when he woke up.
Amen.
And he woke up totally great, totally healed, in his full mind. They said that don't happen. But what had happened in that hospital when we walked in, my EMS was sitting on the shelf somewhere, my carnal mind, and when we operated with the mind of Christ,
amen,
faith rose.
Amen.
We prayed a prayer of faith. That worked really awesome.
Yeah.
And then we get back, and then I go to Deborah's house. And now I don't understand. Lord, I don't know what just happened here. I am fighting this carnal mind when you want me to walk in this.
Amen.
So this is what I get. I looked at the media today. I looked at the media yesterday. And all I could see with the elections was the carnal mind. Totally blah, 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 all over the place. Everybody is frustrated with it because everybody is looking for a man of God.
Amen.
Can I tell you this? You're not going to find it. Can I tell you this, that you're living in the last days? You won't be finding what you're looking for. You're wanting somebody to rise up and to stand for righteousness and someone that will lead this country and its people in the paths of God. I think you're wanting Jesus to return, because you ain't going to find it in an election. But you're looking for the Messiah. Well, so is the Muslims. So is Israel. So are the believers. So what you're looking for in this election, you're going to find. I'm sorry. Because you're looking for Jesus. Not fully understanding you have been given the mind of Christ. All the wisdom of God lies within you. I want you to begin to do this. When you see the media say war and rumors of wars, Jesus said, don't be disturbed.
That's right.
Nation's going to rise against nation, and kingdom's going to rise against kingdom. And there's going to be earthquakes and famines, and all these things will begin to happen. What he said, and you're going to have to do this, when you have the mind of Christ, he said, don't be troubled. Take your carnal mind, sit it on a shelf, and say, I'm not going to listen to you today. Today I will walk in the Spirit. I will feed myself the Word of God. I will believe everything God's Word has to say. Now I'm going to show you something.
Amen.
I'll get that in a minute. This here is truth. You either believe it all or none of it. Either it's all truth or it's not truth. I'm not going to splice it. I'm not going to dice it. And I'm not going to dissect it to see which parts I agree with and which parts I don't.
Amen.
If God says you have the mind of Christ, you have the mind of Christ.
Amen.
For surely, guys, I'm going to tell you, the love of many, the Bible says, is going to grow cold.
Yes.
I'm going to pick on Patty because she shared with me. She's like, did you see her roll her eyes? She rolled her eyes. Yes. Patty came to our booth yesterday. Mary and I were sitting there, we're running the cabin fever rummy sale. In the middle of it, Patty shows up, and just before that, I get a message from somebody that says, I'm coughing up blood. and I need you to pray for me right now. And I'm in the ER, and I'm in extreme pain. So, I couldn't call her. There's no reception there. So I begin to type this prayer. I love Pat. Pat's been my friend for 50, as old as dirt. 54 years.
Amen.
So, long time. She knows me pretty well. But it looked like I was being really rude because she comes up to the booth and she's talking to me and I'm kind of ignoring her because I'm typing this prayer. Long prayer. In the name of Jesus, I take authority over this and I command this bleeding to stop and in this esophagus and this stomach and I command the lining of this to be healed and I went on and on. By the way, she's had no more problems. Amen. Jesus is healing her.
Amen.
I love that.
Jesus has healed her.
But he's still in there. He's working. I know he is because we're going to meet later. But I'm sitting here like this. And I remember Patty was, I saw you're pretty busy. I almost got offended. She said, but this is what I wanted to say. I put on the belt of truth every day, and I knew that wasn't the truth, that you were ignoring me. I knew that wasn't the truth. I knew something must be up. But you were on your phone texting and were not paying attention to me. I said, oh, Pat, I'm so sorry. But I was ministering to somebody in the hospital, and I didn't even think. Please forgive me when I have brain farts. That's what I call them. When I can't piece all the connections together as quick as I need to. I was operating in this and not the carnal mind. If I was operating in the carnal mind, I would have taken the phone, I would have sat down and said, really? Wow. Did you get some really good deals? Oh, I did too. I would have went there. Then I would have went, yeah, I'll get back to you later. What God is teaching me is going to be critical for you to understand this. You are going to get offended somewhere. Whether you choose to accept the offense is going to be your choice. Immediately take this little carnal mind person, that's me, put it on the shelf. Thank you, Pat. You put yours on the shelf. Operate in the mind of Christ. The minute the devil says to you, by the way, don't take tips from your carnal mind. When it says, you know, you might want to really do this. This sounds better than that. In fact, you know, I had never really seen praying for this really work. How's God going to bring the price down on that meat? You know, to your price budget.
Easy.
He will do what he needs to do to meet your need. If you believe his word. If this is really truth, you will gravitate to it, stay in it, meditate it, encourage yourself in the Word of God every day. You will park the carnal mind with what you see coming up in the next few months. If you don't, you're going to be calling me on the phone saying, Deneille, I'm very concerned. Do you know what? Don't lie to me when you're sick and try to fluff it up. Like, if I say, how are you feeling? Well, not too bad. You don't sound very good. No, I threw my back out, but it's not too bad. And then when I say, can I pray for you? You go, well, not really. I'm okay. I can live with it. Because you know what I'm going to say to you? Okay. I love it. I love it when people message and say, we're going to need prayer for this. And I think, okay, we're going to go deal with that. We're going to address that. Because you know what? It will poke at you. And it will cause your carnal mind to become fearful and worry. Address it now. Yesterday at the cabin fever, I went up to a woman and she said, you know, I really like it when you wrote books and painted pictures. I love your pictures. And I said, I don't do that anymore right now. Don't know if I ever will again because now I minister and I pray for the sick. And she said, oh. I said, anybody here sick? She goes, well, I'm always in pain. And I went like, My eyes lit up. I got this little dog bone thing going on. You can, you know how you throw the dog bone. And I just gravitated immediately to that. I said, really? You don't feel well? She goes, oh, I'm used to it. Girl, accustomed to it. It's always there. I have a blown disc, ruptured disc in my back. And I said, Jesus can heal that. Can I pray for you? Now, mind you, we're in the middle of a rummage sale. And there's people all around, so I took her over to the side, and she said, yes, go ahead. So I laid hands on her and prayed. She goes, there was a vibration that came right through your hand into my spine.
Amen.
I said, well, check that out. And at first she went, oh, like this. You know, I thought, oh, great. What did I do now? She said, oh. I said, what's the pain level? She goes, it's like a one. I could live with that. I said, no, let's go after that. We prayed one more time, and do you know what? All pain left.
Amen.
Amen.
Because you know why? I've decided to park. One thought came to me the other day. I was praying for somebody who was going through, let me throw it in, through some really bad hormone changes. So I had her hold my hand like this, and as I began to pray for her, the thought crossed my mind, you know, oh my gosh, that is the carnal mind speaking to me.
Honey, you need to take vitamins. Do you know if you took these things, a little progesterone, that could help here?
I didn't say any of that. But that was my mind. My carnal mind went into gear, and you know what I did? This is really cool. I immediately recognized it for the first time. I grabbed that carnal mind by the throat, and I said, as I was praying, my spirit said this, park it. And I went, and I prayed the will of God over her, and guess what? She got healed.
Amen.
I could tell she got healed. I checked on her a couple times during the night when I also had prayed for her gallbladder. So she ate a full dinner for the first time without any pain. I believe I came across this information not just for you, but for me. So this is something I had dealt with for a long time. How can I pray for the sick when my logical mind says, you know what? They got a stuffy nose. Maybe you should just suggest a little inhaler here and a little medication here. And instantly I begin to realize something. I've been doing that. I've been double-minded, unstable in all my ways. I've tried to operate in both minds. The spirit, the mind of Christ, and the carnal. And what is coming down the line, what I heard the Holy Spirit say, the next 6 months, what you're going to see in the media ain't going to be pretty. And if you operate in the carnal mind, it's going to steal your joy, your hope, your love, your peace. And the love of many is going to grow cold as lawlessness increases. I suggest you begin to filter some things that you see. Begin to filter it out. Put on the belt of truth. In the morning, Patty says, strap the belt on. Say, I'm only going to believe truth. Only going to believe truth. And this is the truth.
Amen.
I'm going to believe the truth about our pastors. Going to believe the truth about my children. I'm going to believe the truth about every person I know that serves God. But I'm going to believe the truth of the Word of God. That is the priority. Anything that comes against the Word of God, if anybody says to you, you can't do that. God don't do that. I'm sorry, he just don't meet those kind of needs. You need to immediately know the devil can lie to your carnal mind. He's really good. First of all, the devil never tells the truth.
Amen.
He does not tell the truth. So if he tells you he's going to destroy you, it's always the opposite. He always
He's a liar.
tells the truth. He's a liar and the father of lies. But if you can park the carnal mind and go, ah, I have the mind of Christ. I was given it the minute I gave Jesus my life. And I will speak the carnal mind. We'll go over here. I will speak the word of God. Park this. No longer gravitate toward it. Don't listen to it. Don't obey it. Don't give it any credence, nothing. It is good for scrubbing the floors, baking the bread, fixing the car. It is really good when you need to fold the laundry to have your carnal mind operate. Pull it down for those things. But when you're in worship, when you're studying the Word of God, immediately, when you hear your kids in trouble, okay, my carnal mind just registered, my kid's in trouble, something's happening, okay. Reach up, grab the carnal mind for a moment when you don't need it. Sit it over here and say, thank you for that piece of information. It was very good of you. Pull out the mind of Christ and begin to pray in the Spirit. Begin to go after that. Begin to quote the Word. But God's Word says this over my kid. The minute you do that, faith is going to rise to a whole different level. So I want to tell you one more thing. I love this part. You are who God says you are.
Amen.
If you've been believing your carnal mind to say anything different, it lied to you. Park it. If it says you're mentally insane or you're in the process of going crazy, if it says your mother is weird and she is a liar, sorry, I've had people say a lot of things to me. And I'll tell you what, if it says your father doesn't know what he's doing at all, and he lacks wisdom, that's really not the Spirit of God speaking. Park it, go find out what God has to say. First of all, he says this, he works in you. He works in you. I know this, I don't know what the last two pages went of my sermon. There they are. Yay. It's always helpful. I like that. If you're going to try to reprogram your carnal mind, good luck. If you think you can teach it enough scriptures to bring it into line, good luck. If you think you can discipline your carnal mind to think correctly and say only the right things, good luck. The Bible says it's always hostile and conflict to the things of God. Every one of you have the Spirit of God living within you. You're going to get a choice in the next 6 months with what you see going on in media and what you see go around you. You're going to get an opportunity to choose between your carnal mind or the mind of Christ. Literally, in my mind, this is what I do now. I pull up, I grab this little carnal mind, and I say, today, I'm going in the hospital to minister to people. You will not be coming along with me. If you need to, you can ride in the back seat of the car. I told Nick, it is staying in the car when I go inside. When I go inside, I'm operating in the spirit mind and the mind of Christ. I'm no longer bringing the carnal mind along. And I park it. You people going to Haiti, you ministers going to Haiti, everybody here that works in a workplace, that deals with people, that deals with family issues, wives that deal with husbands and husbands that deal with wives and families that deal with children, you're going to get to choose this next 6 months if you're going to teach this to your kids when they come home and go, Mom! Oh, I just hate that kid. He's such an idiot. He did this and this happened and the teacher didn't do nothing. Or they come in and go, stupid car. And they kicked its tire. You know, it's just sucking the gas right up. And they go into a little fit. Immediately stop them and say, honey, that's your carnal mind. It's getting so frustrated. Let's park it for a minute and see what God has to say. Park it. Pull out the mind of Christ. He says his provision will be for our lives. That his peace is for your mind. It will cover you. Let's find out what he has to say about your teacher that ignored that issue. Let's pull up the spirit. Let's pull up the mind of Christ. He says we're to pray for her. We're to bless those that curse you. We're to pray for those that despitefully. It'll come out of you. Begin to exercise it. Because in 1 or 2 months when you need this, you're going to need to know how to park the carnal mind and pull up the mind of Christ. Remember, carnal mind's at enmity with God. You have the mind of Christ and the wisdom of God is formed within you. It's there. So something's happened in me and Nick. I fill you in on all the things we go through and the little ups and downs and things that God has asked us. Not you, he's asked us. Netflix. Lord, we're in the middle of a series. Y'all remember that one? Yeah, turn your Netflix off. Limit your media to just these stations and not, don't media surf. That's what he told me. Don't go on your homepage. By the way, I'm not ignoring anybody if I don't respond to you. I don't homepage surf. If your name flips up with a little comment, I'll put a little heart or something underneath it and acknowledge something. But I don't do the scrolling now that I was doing. Because why? He said, I want you in my word more and I want you in prayer more for your people. So I'm not ignoring anybody. He's just literally pulling up roots in me. And Nick, do you know what it's like to come into the house and have it filled with the presence of God because of worship has penetrated the walls? We're at peace in our house. This was my missing piece right here. I needed to know how to put the carnal mind on the shelf and operate in the spirit. So I tell you today, I believe that you have different pastors as of this last couple weeks. We are growing. We're not going to give you mush in the word. We're not going to baby you. We're not going to minimize the word. We're not going to dilute it. We're not going to tell you that we live in a utopia and that everything's going to get better. I'm serious. I hear that too. We're going to be straight up with you to know how to deal and confront difficult things. Because we're going to deal with it with the mind of Christ. I thank you. If you will gravitate toward the Spirit of God in you and park the carnal mind. The carnal mind is what will tell you, hey, look at that chick. She's really good. The carnal mind is what will draw you into viewing things you're not supposed to be seeing. The carnal mind will draw you into fear. The carnal mind will draw you into believing an evil report and never entering the land God gives you. What do you think happened to those 10 spies? They never entered in because they believed the carnal mind. What do you think happened to some of their children? 3 of the tribes. They saw the green grass and it looked better. That was the carnal mind. They never realized, my God shall supply all my needs. He grew that grass over there, he'll grow that grass over here for my cows. Really? That's what kept them out of the promised land was cows? But the carnal mind said to him, oh, you know, your cattle won't have any green grass over there, God's provision isn't enough. God's healing today is enough. His provision is enough.
Yes.
He can do the miraculous
Amen.
That we can't even imagine.
Amen.
Our teenagers want to do it.
Amen.
They want to pray for the sick
Amen.
And see them get healed.
Praise
Listen,
God.
If Pastor Deneille can hold somebody's hand to command pain to leave their body and pain leaves their body, do you think those teenagers filled with the Spirit of God can't do the same thing? We underestimate this. What this cost us. Or cost Jesus. What this cost Jesus. We underestimate what it cost him. This was for, his body was broken, sliced, beaten for you. He said, as oft as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. So we lift up the bread. Father, I thank you for it. Incredible what you did for us, Jesus. We receive this and we remember your body was beaten. It was broken. Every stripe you took was for us. Lord, we decide today, every person here, we will follow the mind of Christ from this moment on. That's what we're deciding. Because of what you did at Calvary, because of the stripes you bore, we believe everything you said about healing, about deliverance, about redemption, about salvation. We believe it all. And we are not believing anything less. You are our provider, our peace, our strength, our joy. So we take this right now. In this cup, he took the cup. He said it's the cup of the new covenant. This is my blood, which was shed for you. You realize what happened? What one drop of this did? It erased every sin you're ever going to commit. You know why? First of all, we're teaching you when you do sin, grace covers it because you're not sinning intentionally. You're not making a mockery of this. Grace covers it. Yep. I love grace. But I'm going to tell you this. The blood of Jesus
covers it.
Also demands holiness. The Bible says without holiness you can't see God. How do you obtain holiness? Through his grace. It empowers you to walk. It empowers you to walk in righteousness. Grace gives you the ability that you can't do in your own flesh. Because everything I just told you about parking that carnal mind, you cannot do it without grace. But because he lives in you, he dwells in you, you can park it. You can take authority over it. You can walk in righteousness. You become holy as he is. All because of what happened here. His blood, his grace. Connect the dots. Grace empowers you to do what you cannot do. All because of this. This is how you accept salvation. Was by grace. Are you saved? It's not anything you earned. It's a gift of God. So, Jesus, we thank you for the gift of salvation. When we partake of this cup today, we remember this was a gift you gave us, eternal life, and we receive it in Jesus' name. I challenge you today. This week, when you encounter it, and surely you will encounter something where you're going to have to choose between the carnal mind and the mind of Christ that lives in you. Choose the mind of Christ. Go ahead. I want you to hear this song. Father, I just ask right now in Jesus' name, they would be strong, they would take courage, and they would not fear. They would not fear. They will take the word of God in the mind of Christ, and they'll begin to operate in it. I ask that your presence would overshadow them, protect them, and keep them all week. Every area of their life, in Jesus' name.